This is Brisbane 10 News with Hugh Cornish and Pam Tamblyn.
Tonight, rising housing rates threaten new home buyers.
And a cruise ship slices through a freighter in the Caribbean.
Good evening. Also tonight, police decide not to charge a bus driver over the hit-run death of a child.
And Americans Jack Nicklaus and Curtis Strange share the honours in the Australian Skins Tournament.
The latest home loan interest rates have turned the great Australian dream of owning a home into a nightmare, according to housing industry sources. People buying their first homes are now faced with a seemingly impossible task as interest rates climb towards 17%.
Yesterday, Westpac and the ANZ banks lifted their home loan interest rates to 15.5%. Other major lenders are expected to follow suit this week. According to the president of the Real Estate Institute of Queensland, David Cameron, the problem isn't existing borrowers. He says banks wouldn't lend money unless they were sure of having it repaid despite interest rate increases. Rather, it's the first home buyers who are bearing the brunt of the latest interest crisis.
Yes, it is. The home buyer is becoming further and further away from purchasing a home. In Sydney and Melbourne, it's out of the question. In Brisbane, it's a very tight market for the first home buyer. And I would like to see the federal government, instead of when they wish to tighten up the money market, instead of looking at the home buyer, I think they should look in other directions.
But the bad news doesn't end there.
So I'm a little bit pessimistic over the next 3 months, but let's hope we can hold it at 15.5% because nobody likes to see housing rates go up.
The bankers say the ball is now in the government's court, but Treasurer Paul Keating is on record as saying government monetary policy won't be changing in the next 3 months. And that, says the bankers, could be the straw that breaks the mortgage belt's back.
They used to say that a week was a long time in politics. Now it's becoming a long time in the economy, and things do change fairly rapidly.
Fiona Crawford, 10 News.
Police will not charge the bus driver involved in the tragic hit-and-run accident in Sydney 2 nights ago that claimed the life of a 12-year-old boy. Nathan Connors died when he fell under the wheels of the bus outside a Pagewood shopping complex. The bus was traced to an Urban Transit Authority depot. The driver said he hadn't been aware the accident had happened. Police say he wasn't at fault and he was sent home in shock after being told of the tragedy.
The state opposition today accused the government of squandering millions of taxpayers' dollars on self-promotion. Deputy opposition leader Tom Burns attacked the Premier over this morning's full-page newspaper ad, which he claims is a blatant political campaign.
This full-page ad announcing changes to stamp duty for first home buyers and Housing Commission loan limits has outraged Deputy Opposition Leader Tom Burns.
It's time Mike Ahern started to use the money that taxpayers pay on the real issues, not promoting himself.
Mr. Burns says taxpayers have paid out at least another $50,000 this weekend alone to fund the Premier's self-promotion binge. He says the money could be better spent.
That $50,000 could go into all of those essential things, along with the $20 million they spent last year.
The opposition says it's in possession of documents showing the government is about to launch another major advertising campaign, this time spending $250,000 on the Foreign Land Ownership Register. This being an election year, Labor is unlikely to let the issue rest. Neil McLean, 10 News.
A Cuban freighter has been cut in half by a cruise ship in the Caribbean. The vessel sank within minutes of the collision.
The American cruise ship Celebration sliced through the freighter near Cuba in the early hours of this morning. It hit in the stern near the crew dormitories. The cement carrier Captain San Luis disappeared below the water in just 13 minutes. None of the liner's 1,500 passengers was injured, but three of the freighter's 45 crew remain missing. Another crewman pulled from the water had part of one leg amputated in the collision. Janet Gubber, 10 News.
Prime Minister Bob Hawke has launched his strongest appeal yet for a nuclear weapons ban by India and Pakistan. He made his plea during a lecture in New Delhi as he winds up his Asian tour.
In the prestigious forum of the third Indira Gandhi Memorial Lecture, Bob Hawke took forward his campaign against more nuclear weapons.
India is the one non-nuclear weapon state which has demonstrated a nuclear explosive capability. I frankly wish that capability had not been developed. But given the reality, I urge that you continue firmly to reject the production of nuclear weapons.
Rajiv Gandhi, in a set piece, thank you, avoided the issue. He did reaffirm his personal friendship of Hawke.
Despite these strident differences on nuclear weapons policy, the Indians have given a green light to a major expansion of trade and economic cooperation. With a market of 900 million people, it's an opportunity too good to be missed.
The Hawke visit has given focus to our market drive. Earlier, he and Gandhi witnessed the signing of memorandums of understanding on telecommunications, railways, and meteorology. Our trade now is worth $750 million. It's leapt more than 17% in the past 3 years. Australian businessmen in town for the visit believe it can continue this dramatic surge. Paul Bongiorno, 10 News, New Delhi.
We'll be back soon with an American court's decision between the life of a woman or her child.
And an eagle eye chasing bogeys over Tamworth skies.
Who can you bank on when you're doing your best? When you're getting ahead and it's time to invest. Who can you bank on? Who'll stick around? One minute you're up, the next thing you're down. Who can you bank on when you get on top? To make sure your investments really take off.
Why pay full price for a new Nissan when you can buy it for much less from North Point Nissan and West Point Nissan? They'll give you up to $3,000 cash back. But hurry, it's only while stocks last. At North Point Nissan and West Point Nissan, you'll get great deals like these. $1,500 cash back on new Nissan Navara 1 Tonner, $3,000 cash back on Series 2 Silhouette, and $2,500 cash back on Series 2 Pintara. North Point Nissan Aspley and West Point Nissan Indrapilli. There's no point in looking anywhere else.
Player ready, mow.
A Flymo electric lawnmower starts first time, mulches as it cuts, is fast, and comes with a built-in roller to give you that tennis court look.
Available from MSAA and Retrovision.
This Nissan Pulsar Vector has all the luxury features usually reserved for big luxury cars, like power steering, power mirrors, central locking, power windows, and talk about quiet.
Commencing Monday, an unforgettable Australian mini-series. A powerful story of forbidden love, courage, family honour and revenge. Tanamira, Lion of Singapore, starts Monday, 8:30 on 10.
A New York woman who's been in a coma for 2 months is tonight being prepared for an abortion. Earlier today, the US Supreme Court upheld a decision giving the woman's husband the right to order the operation. But anti-abortion activists say that they'll fight the decision to the end.
Nancy Klein, 17 weeks pregnant, was plunged into a coma last December following a car accident. Tonight she's being prepared for an abortion. Earlier today, New York's highest court upheld a lower court ruling making Klein's husband her guardian and giving him power to order the operation. During lengthy court battles, US doctors testified the abortion could save the woman's life. But activists have protested against the ruling. They are eagerly awaiting a reply to an emergency appeal they filed tonight with the US Supreme Court judge. Michelle Reakin, 10 News.
US authorities have seized $45 million worth of cocaine as they close the net on a major international drug cartel. After 2 years of investigation, narcotics agents believe they are close to their goal.
Raids in Los Angeles overnight saw four Colombian men arrested and the huge stockpile of cocaine seized by police. The Los Angeles operation is believed to be the distribution point for drugs provided by the Colombian Medellin cartel. The men arrested were responsible for organizing the illegal shipments and collecting the proceeds to send on to their Colombian bosses. In the Antarctic, scientists believe an entire generation of seabirds has been killed by oil from a wrecked Argentine supply ship. 12 days after the ship ran aground, the oil leak has been stopped, but more than 500 tons of fuel oil have spread over an area reaching 80 kilometres from the wreck. Scientists say they don't yet know what the spill's long-term impact will be on the fragile Antarctic environment. Janet Gover, 10 News.
The normally tranquil skies over the northern New South Wales town of Tamworth have been shattered by a series of aerial dogfights. The score? Eagle Squadron 1, Locals 0.
No, not another dogfight between the Americans and the Libyans over the Gulf. This is kite flying over Tamworth. Eagle Squadron consists of one very large, very territorial wedge-tailed eagle, which it seems doesn't take kindly to visitors. In a manoeuvre Tom Cruise would be proud of, the leader of Eagle Squadron takes out the intruder in a perfectly executed attack. Locals, while impressed by Eagle Squadron's flying skills, say they may have to reply with more firepower. Until then, the kite squadron remains grounded. Margaret Bates, 10 News.
Queenslanders dug deep into their hip pockets today to help children in hospital. Viewers pledged more than $360,000 during a telethon held at SeaWorld and broadcast live on Brisbane 10.
Work was underway behind the scenes well before the telethon went to air from 7 o'clock this morning. It was a mammoth technical effort involving a temporary studio at SeaWorld and facilities to cross live to activities around the complex during 5 hours of entertainment. Stars of Network 10 shows were flown in from around the country, and before long, huge crowds had gathered to see their favourite personalities.
Please give us a call now and donate some money to the Ronald McDonald House Appeal.
The appeal attracted strong support from the beginning. The phones rang solidly with pledges to help children in hospital. The money will go to the Ronald McDonald House Appeal, a fund which was established 10 years ago in Sydney. It provides accommodation for the families of children who require long-term medical treatment. The Ronald McDonald House in Brisbane will be established near the Mater Children's Hospital, with construction expected to begin 3 months from now. As the tally increased, the crowds were treated to some spectacular entertainment, including a tug of war between the Brisbane Broncos and the Gold Coast Giants, which went haywire when the rope broke. By midday, after 5 hours on the air, the appeal had raised $361,825. The most important thing now is for those pledges to be honoured. Donations can be lodged at any branch of the Westpac Bank. Nick Whitehead, 10 News.
Well, that was a great effort. And sports next, and talking of great efforts, David, how did Vaux Road go today?
Well, it's good news here, but firstly, welcome aboard to you and Pam.
Thank you.
And after the break, we'll show you how the champion Queensland Galloper scores an all-the-way win.
Ladies and gentlemen, start your engine.
Join the celebration at the 1989 Brisbane International Motor Show.
I've been researching the facts. And the clinical tests prove there isn't a pain reliever more gentle to the stomach than Panadol. Panadol from Winthrop has pure paracetamol, so Panadol provides effective relief from headache, pain, and fever. And you know you can trust it. But remember, always use Panadol only as directed. And please, see your doctor if pain persists.
There are cards, cards, and more cards. But there is only one card that gives you the chance to win $10,000 worth of gold. It's the Sunday Mail Gold Card, only in this week's Sunday Mail. Strike gold at the motor show, where the Sunday Mail is giving away the Super Saab that has everything. And we mean everything. Watch the bullets go for gold with this fantastic wall chart. Plus, win a golden opportunity to be on the set of the sensational new series Mission Impossible. All this and more in your bigger, better value solid gold Sunday Mail.
In 1982, Australia's best-selling car was the Ford Falcon. In 1983, it was Falcon again. 84, Falcon. 1985 and 86, Falcon. 87, Falcon again. And in 1988, once more, Ford Falcon convincingly outsold all competitors. Falcon owners aren't just driving the car of the year, they're driving the car of the decade.
Player ready, mow!
A flymower electric lawnmower starts first time, mulches as it cuts, is fast, and comes with a built-in roller to give you that tennis court look.
Available from MSAA and Retrovision.
This summer, get tough on fleas. Exilpet Flea Liquidator. It kills more fleas than the leading flea collar. Exilpet Flea Liquidator. Don't just collar fleas, liquidate them.
Welcome back, and firstly tonight to golf, and Americans Jack Nicklaus and Curtis Strange are both $105,000 richer after the first day of the Australian skins in Port Douglas. The Golden Bear stole the honours, winning 9 skins, while Strange won 8. But Queensland's Greg Norman finished the day without winning a cent.
There was no shortage of incentive for the players. On top of the $10,000 a hole skin, a hole in one on the second was worth $250,000. Curtis Strange went very close.
Look at this.
Strange birdied the hole to pick up $20,000. The American, who many believe is the best player in the world, was also on target at the next to birdie the third and pocket another $10,000.
Which he gets.
Greg Norman found trouble early on, but was peppering the pin. The 35 degrees heat was taking its toll as the players took their time around the resort course. Nicklaus was having trouble reading the speed of the greens. On the sixth hole, $30,000 jumped in and then out of the Golden Bear's pocket. On the par 3/8, a hole in one would win you a $1 million condominium, and Norman showed his sense of humour.
Right over the stick.
Yeah, well, I didn't want the condominium anyway.
Nicklaus had threatened to win a big skin. On the ninth, he boosted his bank account by $60,000.
Yes.
Yes.
The bear may be past his best, but comes up with the winners when the money's on offer. This birdie on 12 was worth a cool $45,000. Yes. This approach on 14 won Curtis Strange another $30,000, taking his total to $60,000. Aoki had been off target all day, but came good with a birdie on 15 to grab a lousy $15,000.
At last!
The final hole, $45,000 up for grabs, and Curtis Strange comes as close as you can to a hole-in-one. Terry Kennedy, 10 News.
And while Greg Norman is struggling for the big dollars at Port Douglas, he's involved in a row over his appearance fees for the Tournament Players' Championship this month at Riverside Oaks. Norman's management group, IMG, have issued a bankruptcy notice against the tournament organiser, Graham Beach. But Beach denies any money problems exist.
IMG General Manager James Erskine says Beach owes $300,000 appearance money to Greg Norman, David Graham and Roger Davis. Erskine says, "It's now a legal matter, and hopefully it will all be resolved." He says, "We have no wishes to upset the TPC, but in the event the players are not paid, the whole tournament will be in jeopardy." Beach admits he hasn't paid the money, but the tournament is still 12 days away.
In defence of their argument, their contract calls for payment 30 days prior to the tournament. That has always done that, and we've always not done that. We've always paid 4 or 5 days before.
But Beach says there are wider implications.
So we are head-to-head competitors, but they also sell your players. So there's a lever they can use, if you could use that sort of term, to make life difficult for a competitor.
Norman is contracted to play the TPC and the Australian PGA for another 2 years. Beach says Riverside Oaks will be staging major events long after that. Bill Woods, 10 News.
And still on golf, and Sydney's Peter Fowler is through to the semi-finals of the Australian Match Play Championship after knocking out the defending champion Ronan Rafferty today. Fowler will play Victorian David Smith, and the other semi-final will be between, I'll put those back in a moment, Newcastle's John Clifford and Queensland's Ozzie Moore. And now to cricket, and New South Wales has taken first innings points in the Sheffield Shield match against South Australia at the Sydney Cricket Ground. The Blues declared just one run past the visitors' total at 6 for 357, and in reply, South Australia was 3 for 89 in its second innings. And now we move to baseball, and the Brisbane Rams has made up for what has been a disappointing baseball season with a win over the visiting Japanese team, the Chunichi Dragons, on the Gold Coast. The Japanese professionals were expected to produce a strong showing, but the Rams played control baseball to take the match 4-3.
The match attracted enormous interest from the Japanese media, but the Dragons' huge following was disappointed as the Rams took control early. Brisbane scored twice in the second inning, with Tony Thompson and Peter Vogler both getting home as the side strung together some consistent hitting. The lead was stretched in the third inning when a Dave Nielsen drive to right field sent Peter Wood home. Rams pitcher Adrian Marr was in good form, and it took a fumble at third base to allow the Dragons off the mark. The teams took one run each in the sixth innings, but the Rams hung on for an impressive victory. Peter Kelly, 10 News.
And as we told you earlier in the bulletin, gallant Queensland frontrunner Vo Rogue showed all his champion qualities today in winning the CF4 Stakes at Sandown. Starting a hot odds-on favourite, Vo Rogue was swamped with challenges on the home turn, but fought back to kick away and win easily.
Rogue, at the start of a tough month of racing, was out to take it easily today. He seemed to be playing with the field and had plenty in the tank when the challenge came.
Vo Rogue a length and a quarter in front of Superimpose, who's coming home like a train. Vo Rogue finds something, though, like all champions do. He's a length and a quarter in front, and he's much too good. Superimpose second, Ma Wong third, time is...
Later, trainer Vic Rail was surprised by the slick time.
I knew in my own heart that he was only kidding to him, you know what I mean? And we know the horse can find plenty, and to be honest, I think Cyril was playing with him down the straight.
The feature event in Sydney, the Hobartville Stakes, saw a great run from Research with the blue cap. At 200 metres, he had nowhere to go, switched to the outside and stormed home.
Research got chopped out. He's got a switch across the heels of the two leaders. Swiftly, Carson drew clear. The filly Research is charging home. She's going to be a good thing beaten, I think. Oh, golly, I'm not sure. Right,
it looked like a dead heat, but Swiftly, Carson won the photo. Earlier, Bart Cummings' Campaign King started even money favourite in the Group 2 Expressway Stakes, but he could only manage third as Groucho kicked away at the home turn.
Groucho holding them at bay easily in the last bit. Look at old Targlish getting home along the fence when it's all over. But Groucho beat at sea. Third close, Campaign King or the strong finish.
But Cummings had more luck with the Group 1 Australasian Stakes in Adelaide, where Stapleton Lass scored an easy win.
Down the outside, Scalata is starting to rock at home, but it'll be too late. And this is going powerfully in the run of the line. Stapleton Lass untroubled to win. Stapleton Lass wins the Oaks easily. Second-placing Memphis Blues, third Scalata, then imposing...
Peter Kelly, 10 News.
Thanks, Peter. And finally tonight, the grudge match between Australia's two fastest cyclists is now a war on wheels. Queensland's Gary Niewon leads the series 2-0 after last night's showdown in Melbourne, while Stephen Pate is licking his wounds after a bad fall.
It was the first series of clashes for the arch-rivals in 3 years. World professional sprint champion Stephen Pate versus Australia's top amateur Gary Niewon. The spectacular fall left Pate nursing a battered and bruised body. Today, reflecting on what went wrong, the war of wheels turned into a war of words.
Gary led out, which is, I think, is his plan. I rode him the way I wanted to. I've given him distance and I was up high. Coming into the final bend, he's, you know, meant to hold a straight line, which is in the rules. And he's come halfway up the bend and, you know, sort of flicked me around the track and put me off balance.
Judges finally abandoned the third race, leaving Seoul Olympic bronze medalist Gary Niewon with a 2-0 lead in the best of nine series. As Pate says, the fall only added to his woes.
I had a bit of trouble the first two heats, so I put on the wrong gear, which is no excuse, it's my own fault. And I mucked up, which I was on my training gear and I didn't realise. So the first two rides I rode on that gear, which gave me a lot of confidence for the third ride, but then this happened, so I'm still very confident for next week.
Well, that's sports for Saturday, Hugh, but of course the Channel 10 All-Stars take on the Lord Taverners to raise money for the Ronald McDonald House tomorrow at New Farm
Park. That's obviously got to be the highlight of
it. It will be, I can assure you.
I'll be looking for
it. I believe you're breaking your retirement there too.
Oh, you never know. Thanks, David. After the break, the weather details.
Monday on Page One, Brad Robinson with cricket's winning War Brothers. And as Bill Hayden packs for Yarralumla, a Chris Masters exclusive interview. Page One, presented by Toyota Camry. Monday, 7:30 on 10.
Where do you go to for pleasure?
PRES, Professional Real Estate Service at Alexandra Headland, has served the Sunshine Coast since 1966. PRES are major letting agents of luxury high-rise and low-rise unit accommodation. PRES are major selling agents, having a wide variety of quality homes, units, land, first-class investments and businesses. Phone PRES, PRES today for brochures and details of property on the Sunshine Coast. You are welcome always. We sell, we let, we care.
This is David Taylor, aged 3. By the time he's looking for a new car, he'll expect it to have four-wheel drive, four-wheel steering, infrared navigation and communication systems, and dynamic safety-matched performance. David Taylor, your new car is ready. The Mitsubishi HSR, the most intelligent car ever built, brings the technology of tomorrow to cars from Mitsubishi today.
What's happening to natural childbirth? Read in tomorrow's Sunday Sun how artificial womb births are only a matter of time.
See how the latest James Bond, Australia's Timothy Dalton, goes slapstick.
Meet 89-year-old Nellie Bowley. She's bright, independent, and to dingoes, deadly.
Read about the new wave celebrities and their secrets of success.
Get your free VIP Sun card for prizes, cash, discounts, and special offers.
And the $65,000 Sun pool's been won. Is it you?
It's brighter in the Sunday Sun.
Flight 404 will be delayed. Flight 404 is still delayed.
Mitchum antiperspirant. It's so effective, even if you had to skip a day.
Flight 404 is finally boarding.
You could.
Tonight's weather proudly brought to you by Castlemaine Perkins.
Let's find out what's happening on the weather front. All no storms gone yet, Noel.
Well, practically, we might have one or two around tomorrow just to liven things up. But generally, I think things are starting to tidy up. In fact, if we take a look at the viewing area today, we can see that things haven't been too bad at all. Temperatures are around about normal, fairly warm, actually, particularly in the inland sections. And we've got a reasonable sort of a flow onto the coast, but the moisture is fairly shallow, so we're not expecting too much to worry about there. Just taking a look at our cloud cover now, we can see we've got Tropical Cyclone Harry. Now, Harry's the worry. It's a long way offshore, but it could drift south. And as it does, it could combine with this cold front we've got here. And if that does happen, we could get some stronger winds on the coast, possibly Monday or even Tuesday, and that should return us to showers, because across the top we've got that monsoon trough. Let's take a look at today's chart anyway. You can see we've got Harry, we've got that circulation of low pressure around it, plus the monsoon trough. We've got this cold front here, which at the present time is just around about Fraser Island. We expect it will get to Mackay and then weaken out. And tomorrow we can see that we've had a bit of a change there. Harry is still there, but coming down southwards, we've got quite a good high pressure system moving across the gradient between the pair, starting to squeeze up, so it looks as though Tuesday back into showers for the south coast area. Well, in the capital cities, it's rather interesting, actually. Most of them are fine, apart from Darwin. Darwin will have a storm, and Perth should make it to 30 degrees tomorrow, so quite warm over there. Well, in the Brisbane region, we'll be mainly fine. We've got a chance of a brief afternoon shower. We'll have light to moderate southeast and northeasterly winds, a minimum of 21, and we're expecting a maximum of 29 degrees. Well, in the viewing area tomorrow, fairly much the same as today, except we will have these southeasterlies running through early, first of all. That'll keep things fairly cool. What will happen then? The northeasterlies will move back in the afternoon. Temperatures will start to rise again. We're expecting to get up to around about 30 degrees. And, of course, back around Toowoomba, the temperatures are down just a fraction, down to about 26. But there could be the odd thunderstorm around that area tomorrow. As far as the coast is concerned, just the odd shower late in the afternoon. Well, we look at Moreton Bay, we've got northeasties of 10 to 15 knots, and they'll generate from the southeasties of 10 to 15 knots in the morning, so about a metre of sea, some areas a lot less than that around the edges. Offshore, we've got about 2 metres of swell. On the southern end of the bay, we're not expecting too many problems there. The coastal bars all seem right at this point, and we've got between a metre and 0.9 of a metre on that southern end. Our tide times, our high will be at 2 metre at 1.52 and sunrise at 5.29. The three-day outlook, mainly sunny on Sunday, Monday fine, and Tuesday should be mainly fine. Well, that's about it for the weather. Right now, I think we'll go back to Hugh.
Thanks, Noel. That's the Brisbane 10 News for Saturday, the 11th of February, 1989. Actually, Pam, I can't wait for tomorrow night's news. I want to see David's batting, and I want to see where Harry the Cyclone is on the weather map. I mean, God.
Between Harry and David batting. We hope you can join us tomorrow night for Brisbane 10 News. Good night.
Good night.
Brisbane 10 and Skyfleet Toyota present the Lord's Taverners Charity Cricket Spectacular, New Farm Park, Sunday, 12th February from 11 a.m. It's free. Win a trip to Lord's. Meet the stars and rock and roll's a great entertainment. New Farm Park, Sunday, 12th February.